What's going on, everyone? It's Sonny here, day 3 WonderCon. Let's check out all these comics and let's wrap this day up. Let's go.
Okay, so here at the Geek Speak Show, we found some monsters, or someone who writes about monsters. Tell us about your latest project.
All right, it's called Monster Elementary, and it's about these 5 elementary school-aged monsters. They go to an all-monsters private school. It's like the perfect kind of school for kids like this. But then the school gets raided by the FBI, and so they're forced to go to a human public school, which is kind of awkward for them. They don't fit in very well. They're not allowed to eat the other kids. It's a strange situation for them.
So how do they prevent themselves from like eating like the humans or the kids? Or?
Well, some harsh words from their parents and a little bit of good behavior. A little bit is about all they have, a little bit of good behavior.
And what are some of the characters that you have in your book?
So let me show you. There we go. So this is the book right here. This is Desmodus. He's the vampire child and kind of the leader of the group. This is Rags. He's the mummy, and he's got kind of an identity issue. He's adopted by a couple of Egyptologists, so he doesn't really know who he is or where he's from. So he kind of tries on different personalities and such. Francesca is the Frankenstein monster right here, and she's obviously kind of big and strong and gruff and really gentle on the inside and doesn't quite find, she's always trying to find a way to fit in and having a hard time at it. Lucas is the werewolf boy. He's Dez's best friend, and he's kind of the one that looks out for everyone and tries to keep them, you know, rein them back and keep things from going too out of control. But on the flip side of that, he's also got an addiction to juice boxes.
Why juice boxes?
For me, that's kind of the I think of werewolves as sort of an allegory for alcoholism.
Wow.
And I think the kid version of that is the juice box. And so he kind of goes nuts over juice boxes all the time. And then that's Gilda. She's the lagoon monster. And she's just essentially an id. She just does what she wants. She's a happy and go-lucky, just doesn't even understand that other people think she's weird.
That's cool. I know what it's like to be weird. But how did you come up with the inspiration for your characters? Did you kind of like interview or kind of like observe kids and what they're going through, or in terms of bullying and kind of like figuring out what their differences is in school? Or did you kind of use inspiration from like old classic monsters?
It was a lot from the classic monsters. I mean, if you take a look, it's essentially the 5 main universal monsters, you know, transformed and re-envisioned in my way. As far as, you know, I was a kid once. We were all a kid once. We all kind of remember how weird and awkward that is. And I think that, you know, using the monsters like this is just a way of being able to really shine a light on that, how we feel different and how we don't fit in, when in fact of the matter is we're all just people.
So what is the overall message that your audience can take away from your creation?
Well, for me, the most important thing was fun. It was to have a really fun comic book that was good for all ages. And I had fun writing it, I had fun making it, and I think people will have fun reading it. The central theme, of course, is about fitting in, like we were saying. So there's a lot of issues with the kids not fitting in the school and not belonging, not being a part of this, or not even wanting to be it sometimes.
That's cool. And where can people get your book or check it out?
Right now, the book was delivered to us on Tuesday. So this is our first show. This is our first big deal. We have a Facebook page. It's, you know, facebook.com/monsterelementary. You can actually find that easily by going to monsterelementary.com. And we're going to be setting up a web store soon. Hopefully Monday, in fact. But, you know, that depends on how fast we are at these things. But you can definitely find us on the Facebook page and follow us there. And more to come.
If you had to add another monster, who would you add?
That's a good question. I'm trying to work my way through and have everything. So the book actually has some skeletons in it. It's got some zombies. They're papier-mâché zombies. We also have a... what am I thinking? I lost my train of thought.
It happens all the time.
But I try to do everything. I think... next, I need to do like a Jekyll and Hyde monster, maybe. I do have a ghost penguin in this book. But yeah, I definitely like set out to, I gotta have everything. So yeah, maybe an invisible boy.
A lot of cool monsters coming. So that's all we have for Monsters High right now. Thank you for your time.
All right.
Thank you. So we found more cool books, and here's our new friend, Ashley.
Hi, I'm Ashley. I am the owner of Inksmith Publishing. We are a traditional publisher just located outside of Los Angeles, California. We publish everything from fantasy fiction, sci-fi, horror, crime dramas, thrillers, and paranormal. We don't publish romance, political, and religious novels.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Paranormal, how did you get involved with paranormal stuff?
Well, we really started out with horror, sci-fi, and fantasy, but we got some really great submissions across our submission door, and one of them happened to be from a current author of ours, Julie Flanders, who did a great paranormal mystery called The Ghosts of Aquina, and she is a great writer, and we had to pick it up.
Awesome. So, your mom, I believe, she told us a little bit about your work here.
I like to call her my minion.
Your minion? Minions are cute. They're nice. What are some of your books here, because they all have like delicious covers?
They're all different. We have some young adult titles, we have some adult titles. Our two bestsellers are actually both comedic novels. One follows the life of a Ford Galaxy, the other is written in suicide notes, a dark humor. Our young adult novels can range from a pirate novel to a girl who goes on a wonderful adventure across space. Ash Wednesday is a post-apocalyptic novel with a dystopian feel. Five Corners, written by Kathy Shaw over here, is our first international author, and it's a very unique book. These young adults have marks on them, and they can change into animals, and they have control of protecting our Earth. So they all range, they're all different titles. Like I said, some are adult, some are young adult, but we tend to cater to general public, not so much age range, but yeah, so we have a nice range of books.
One of the books that I really kind of was really attracted to for a while, I believe it's called The Silence.
Yes.
Tell us about that. That looks really amazing.
Right. So The Silence was our first book in our catalog. It was also my book. I figured, what not a better way to start off my company by at least giving my book a try. So that way, if I made any errors, it would be my book and not someone else's. So The Silence is a zombie novella, and it's based upon, like, about...
How did you get involved with zombies and novellas? That's right. Two different... What?
So novellas, in book terms, is a book under 60,000 words, or set by a publisher. It's not the novellas we...
Yeah, I was like, wait a minute.
And this zombie actually follows the life of the people surviving in the apocalypse, not so much the blood and gore of zombies. So it is more like Walking Dead, per se, and not so much, oh, blood everywhere, yum, you know? It's not like that.
So what are you hoping for the young adult genre? Because we talked a lot to other authors and stuff like that. They kind of don't like the word young adult. Mm-hmm. How do you feel about that, and how are your books kind of opening the gap?
I agree. I don't like it as well. I've had a lot of people go, oh, it's a young adult. Well, not so much. It's a book that everyone can read. It doesn't have graphic sex or profanity. So it's a clean book is what we'd like to describe it. So therefore, we can call it young adult. So it doesn't have to be young adult. It's just a clean book. So that's... If we're going to be more precise, that's kind of what we call it. Our young adult ones, like Billy Scarlet, yes, it is geared more towards the ages of 13 to 18, just by the way it is written. But something like Adventures of a Space Bum would be great for any adult who likes sci-fi.
Awesome. So what are some of your favorite books or some of your like inspirations that kind of came about before you started like writing your own book,
right?
Which is crazy.
My favorite book outside of my publishing company is Lord of the Rings. I absolutely love the series. I love The Hobbit. I love The Silmarillion. I love all of his works. It's absolutely wonderful. As a publisher, I'm not supposed to have favorites, but I have three favorites. I have favorite book, which is Scream If You Want to Go Faster, favorite author, The Funeral Portrait, and favorite cover, Demon Theory, which is actually our latest release.
Yeah, I looked at the Demon Theory. I was like, whoa.
I don't think I'm supposed to have favorites, but I do.
But you do. You had to get it from somewhere, all your inspiration. So where can like people go to check out your stuff?
Our books are on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, or our website, which is www.ink-smith.com.
Awesome. So Ashley, thank you so much for your time. We're going to check out your books and your paranormal stuff.
Wonderful.
You can check us out anytime or come on the show and talk and stuff. Awesome.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you.
The Geek Speak Show at WonderCon Anaheim 2014. Guess who I found? Say hi.
Hi.
Hello.
The Winter Twins. You've heard them on the show. Now you get to see them. Now, we talked about the books and everything before. We were at the panel last night. Big, big announcement. Tell everybody what it is.
Well, Britt and I are writing a movie which is going to be starring and being produced by Rampage Jackson. Yes, and we announced it yesterday at our panel. So we should be filming by the end of the year. Woo!
Yeah, so let's get a little bit behind the scenes. Like when did all this start, or when did you guys start planning and writing and everything?
Well, actually, it was a weird turn of events of how we met Rampage and ended up working with him. We met through Tweet Secret, the company, and he heard about our story that we were creating before it was even written, and fell in love with it, and it got picked up.
How would you describe it, the movie?
It's going to be really fun. It's going to be kind of like Mad Max meets Riddick. It's going to be really fun sci-fi.
Sold.
It's going to be a little post-apocalyptic, whole lot of action.
So, and why were all the wrestlers on the panel with you guys?
Because they're going to be in it. They're all in it. And we're actually going to have some more actors that are going to be involved. But actually, they're not actually initially wrestlers or fighters. They're actors, so which is kind of cool. We're going to have a whole eclectic mix of people. The great thing about wrestlers is that they have all acting experience. A lot of them went to college for acting, and they have fight experience. So a movie like this utilizes all of their initial talents.
Yeah, so that's obviously going to keep you both a little busy. But talk about the books also, in case somebody hasn't heard of them.
Well, our first series is called the Strand Series. And that's the series we really became known for here at the convention circuit and everything else. The first one's Strand Prophecy. Second's Distinctions Embrace. And it's a sci-fi superhero. Well, think of it as a sci-fi superhero movie in book form. It's really fast-paced. It's really fun. It's in modern day. It's kind of dark. It's kind of gritty. And it's a series of three, the third coming out later this year.
Yeah, and also you have the Motivate to Learn and everything else that you talked on the show. Tell them all about that.
Yes, we also have a nonprofit, Motivate to Learn, in which that we go school to school and help kids that are underprivileged with learning disabilities. So we donate speech to text programs, we donate books, we do the most that we can for the kids. And we've been in front of over 150,000 kids in the last couple of years.
Yeah. So again, back to the movie. I know it's going to take a while, just because movies are always like that. When do you hope to have it out?
Actually, we hope to be filming by the end of the year. Things should be moving pretty fast. So follow up in a month or so, and I'll let you know the rest of the information.
So tell them where they can follow you, websites, everything.
WinnerTwins.com. So Winner, W-I-N-N-E-R, Twins, T-W-I-N-S. And that's everything. That's Instagram, that's Twitter, that's Facebook, that's our website.
And that's the Winner Twins. There you go.
In sunny, sunny Anaheim, California. And we're going to fall in this bush. Here we are in sunny, sunny Anaheim, California, and we're here for WonderCon. Is everyone excited for WonderCon? Woo! The energy. Oh my God. One more time. Is everyone excited for WonderCon? And here we are with the Geek Speak Show, and we'll be doing coverage all throughout WonderCon. So keep with us, and let's go.
Hey! So we're going to do a little escalator interviews. Let's see who we got. Hello. I have a question. Flame Princess or Bubblegum Princess?
Bubblegum Princess.
Obviously. Easy question. All right, I got a question. Cats or dogs?
What?
Cats or dogs?
Dogs.
I knew it. DC or Marvel?
Hi.
He said hi. That's not an answer. I don't know what that is. All right, DC or Marvel, sir?
What?
DC or Marvel? DC!
All right, she knows. All right, hi, I have a question for you, lady. Dogs or cats?
Good.
Dogs or cats?
Dogs or cats?
She's a cat lady.
Meow!
How's it going, DC or Marvel?
What?
DC. DC, you're wearing a Marvel shirt.
How's it going, Star Trek or Star Wars?
Neither.
Hey, Punisher or Batman?
Rock on, baby.
All right. Excuse me. Batman or Punisher?
What?
Batman or Punisher?
Punisher.
He knows what's up. All right, last one right here. Oh, hello. Oh,
wow.
I don't even know what you guys are supposed to be. You guys threw me off. Hello. Captain America or Batman?
Captain America.
Oh. Ooh. She likes a rule. Mario or Luigi?
Neither.
He's a Koopa kind of guy.
Wonder Woman or Catwoman?
He looks at me. We're asking all the hard questions. DC or Marvel?
There we go.
Matt Murdock. Love is blind, and so is the law. DC or Marvel? Captain America or Captain Planet? DC or Marvel?
Totally.
Marvel.
Too bad Marvel's not a WonderCon. DC or Marvel?
Yeah.
Two-Face or Joker?
Oh, who do you think?
Two-Face? Pokemon or Digimon?
Pokemon!
Guys, Pokemon or Digimon?
Pokemon.
Oh.
DC or Marvel?
DC.
That's a good one. Captain America or Captain Planet?
America.
America always wins. Here we go.
Star Trek, Star Wars?
Star Trek or Star Wars? We're in the stars tonight. Ooh. DC or Marvel?
Hey.
You don't like comics, so why is he here? I don't know. Why are you here? Geek Speak Show or Nerded? So we're going to talk to some people, and we're going to ask them what they think about the local flavor of WonderCon Anaheim. How's it going, guys? We're the Geek Speak Show. We just have a quick question about the food choice. What did you guys order today?
Spicy barbecue beef.
And do you like it?
It's good. It is.
Taking a bite of it yet? It looks like it's been... Two bites. Yeah, can we get a fruit? Let's get the audio of him eating. Can you take a bite for us on a camera?
Let's see if I can.
You did it.
There you go. That's good.
Ooh. Thanks for talking to us, guys. Enjoy your sandwich. It was a sandwich, right? It was a sandwich. Was that a barbecue sandwich? I want my baby back. That's actually copyright infringement. Back. All right. Can I sit here? Okay. As with any food trucker in WonderCon, you gotta find your own spot. And let me see this real quick. Hold it like this. I got the steak quesadilla. We got the shrimp tacos. I got bad posture. And I also got the Wonder Bowl. This is the special WonderCon thing that every geek loves to eat after conning it up for so long, because you need your carbs, you got your shrimps, you got your protein, you got your chipotle sauce for the flavor, and let's try it out.
All good. Oh yeah.
So you got the steak quesadilla.
Oh my god. I mean, when they can't have him.
Bye, Felicia. Ha ha ha. We're at the Pud Drive, the open bar. For WonderCon, and who I'm talking to?
Nora Whitehouse, team supervisor.
And?
Valerie Aladini.
And it's cool because we wanted to show that there's other stuff going at WonderCon other than comic books and movies and all that stuff. And we're really excited to hear that there's a blood drive. And so far, how has the blood drive been going?
It's been going really great. You know, the donors here yesterday and today, they've been so nice because there's been a long wait, unfortunately. And they're all very nice about waiting and it's been fun.
Cool. And is there a lot of need for blood in the area?
Always. Do you know that we actually import 30% of our blood from the Midwest? So when they have bad weather or troubles over there, it affects us here in California.
Yep. The heartland gives us some blood to the heart.
Yes, because only 2 to 3% of Californians donate blood. So our donor supply here from Southern California is not good at all. We need to get more like the Midwest.
Well, we got some people here. Can you check out the crowd? Very lively crew because
they got every kind of costume here. Everyone has been like so great, and they understand that everyone who donates here today, within a week, all the blood that we collect here, after it's gone back to our labs, broken down, tested to make sure it's all okay, it'll go to all the local hospitals, and each person here can help up to 3 people get out of hospital beds and home with their families. And that is huge. And I just commend all the donors here because they came here to have fun. Yet they came up here and they've been waiting to donate blood because they understand that they want to do something good as well. So, hats off.
Quick question, like I know like a lot of people are in costume and anything. Any weird costumes where you had to like move around to get the needle? Get the needle in?
Actually, it's been really good. Everybody's been real good about, you know, making sure we get access
yeah,
to
they
the
took
arms.
Their, I shouldn't say took their clothes off, but yeah. kind of took
to,
their clothes
to.
off, and we had t-shirts for them. So if they had the long sleeve in an outfit, then we gave them a t-shirt, so they were able to do that. But
so then
they were
I guess last question would be like, so for anyone giving their blood, do they get anything? You know, like a sugar cookie, some juice?
Of course, the snacks and juice and water. And now we had some promotions today. We had Quiznos, I think buy one get one free.
Yep.
Some discounted tickets to Galaxy and Grammys,
Museum,
and the Lab Factory and T-shirts.
Oh, and then lastly, is there a goal? Like amount, like X amount of pints?
Yes,
our question he's asking.
I went to school.
Yeah. Today was, I believe,
my mom's a nurse.
72
pints?
Yeah.
And where are we right now?
We're at, last time I checked, we were about 52.
Oh, we could maybe take five pints.
I think we're going to go way over 72 because we had like over 100 people sign in today.
Hey, so WonderCon.
Awesome. Yeah.
Giving the blood, this is the lifeline of WonderCon and the world and California.
That's right.
Starve a vampire, donate blood.
Uh-huh. Or what we like to call the open.
And Mike Sheffield here is one who is responsible for getting the Red Cross involved and running the blood drive.
He's got some muscle to him. How's it going?
The Heinlein Society.
Right,
cool.
For Robert Heinlein, the science fiction author. He was very, believed greatly in blood donation. His life was saved by a number of people donating blood when he needed it, and so it was very important to him. He organized the first blood drive at a science fiction convention in 1976 when he was the guest of honor at the World Science Fiction Convention in Kansas City.
When did he pass?
1988.
Okay, so then, wow, it's been going on for, 26 years now? You said this started in
1976 was the first convention that I know of having a blood drive.
That's cool.
And Comic-Con International in San Diego has had one since 77 every year.
And can I ask you what your outfit is, by the way?
This is a utility kilt. Not any particular character.
A little bit, I thought, because you know it's Easter, and he had the long hair, the beard. I was about to say.
I just have long hair here. That's all.
Jesus wish he had just had his muscles, you know.
No.
Thanks for talking to us. And
all right, thank you.
And here we are, blood drive at WonderCon Anaheim.
We are exhausted, sort of. So much energy, but last day, Sunday, WonderCon Anaheim 2014. What'd you guys get? All weekend.
What did I get? Some good interviews with Ali Larder.
Arthritis.
What'd you get, Joel?
We got a lot of cool interviews with a bunch of people. You're going to see us on the floor. You're going to see us outside by the fountain talking to cosplayers.
You see those food trucks that we got?
We got some food trucks. You get the taste of the local flavor of Anaheim.
You got some good interviews for y'all to check out. Yep. Legends, The Last Ship.
What else, Joel? We talked to some red carpet interviews, and we also talked to the commoners,
yep.
the people
the lowly
on
folk.
The floor, you know? The people like us, you know?
Yeah.
Because we're
How about you, Henry?
We're a bunch of crumb bums,
you
know?
Who'd you talk to this weekend?
I talked to security to get you guys out of here because who are these people? If you don't know, then obviously you're not listening to the Geek Speak Network because their show, The Superheroes Lounge, is one of the newest, the biggest, the funnest. You know Joel already. This is Sonny. So what are you guys going to talk about this, whenever your new episode comes out?
Our new episode.
Our workout regimens and...
Yeah, no. Our new episode is coming out this week, this Friday, and it's going to be about superheroes and
vacations.
Yes.
Because we're in the sun, the hot sun.
We took a two-week break. I'm sure superheroes do that too.
We need to recap. We are superheroes.
I am a superhero. Yeah. I don't know about you. You're a villain. You're the super villain over here.
I have the power to stumble over my words, and
I have the power to make them stop.
I have the power to cut them off. So that's the last day. We're going to go angelize. We're going to go somewhere. We're going to get some final people out on the floor. Not literally on the floor. But again, if you're not here, you can watch it through us on the YouTube channel. This is a big old video that you're watching now. If you want to watch individual ones, if you have ADD and you lose if you lose the attention span, then go to the little thing called the Wrap Up of Con, C-O-N. Get what I did there? And you can watch them all individually there. Okay. Everybody ready?
Yep.
Ready for a little get together in July?
Oh, yeah.
In San Diego?
A little Comic Con.
Don't you lie to me.
Get ready for that. Pack up.
We'll be back.
So we're here with Tone Rodriguez at WonderCon. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. Having fun on the last day.
Yes.
So what's going on? What'd you bring for us?
Oh, we're just, here. I mean, we're here to literally, the most important thing is just to meet fans. But, we have prints out and we have people coming up asking for commissions, on comic books and whatnot.
Yeah.
So it just, all sorts of stuff. But, for the most part, it really is just an opportunity to have the fans show up and sign books and whatnot. So.
And how long did it take you to pack up all your work and everything? Because we last saw you at APE.
Okay, yeah.
East Space Comic Con was another one. We've been to so many cons.
Yeah, I didn't have a regular setup there. This stuff is always packed up.
It's ready to go?
We never have it not packed up. It takes up a little corner in the studio. It just sits there. And if for whatever reason I need to get into it, it's right there. But, it doesn't take any time. We tear down pretty quick, too. Like, these things are, the only thing that's,
take time to pack up. Yeah.
But, if you unhook it from the top, the thing just drops down. So, if you want to cut some time off your breakdown,
So how do you go about picking your stuff? Are you just I have a copy of this at home, I'm just going to pack it in for the fans? Or
most of the stuff that I actually draw and do, I'll never, ever even bring to a show. The comic book pages. One of the reasons why is, when I do the Simpsons stuff, the company holds onto those pages.
Yeah.
I'm compensated for it. And so I never have those pages. And then all of the regular comic book pages or all the regular comic book artwork, I never bring to a show because I kind of feel like nobody really wants those. And I, in addition to that, I store all of it. I have it all packed up in
locked
a special
away.
Place. And then what I do bring is I bring covers, pinups, commissions, things that I just do or people might have a little more interest in, like I said, a cover. Whereas, a comic book page, sometimes they don't show that much interest in it. We'll see how it goes in another couple of years.
Yeah.
Right now, it just seems to be they always want covers or they want pinups or whatnot. So.
Do you have any upcoming projects for us?
The only project that we've been actively working on for the last couple months has been the Sakai project. And we've been trying to promote this as much as we can. But the Comic Art Professional Society, we are an organization of comic book creators. And it really was just a social club originally.
Mm-hmm.
It was originally started by people like Mark Evanier and Jack Kirby and a few other people, Sergio Aragonés. And it was just a way of basically getting a bunch of people together and hanging out, relaxing, talking about work, but not actively working.
Yeah.
And it was started almost 40 years ago when, at the time, most people were still working in comic books in New York. And then they started moving to California. So, Jack Kirby came out here and then Marv Wolfman came out here and a few other people. And because, we started working in television and whatnot.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, so that's the history of CAPS. But in recent years, we've started branching out as a nonprofit to basically try to raise funds for things like the Hero Initiative.
Yeah, we know about
and
that.
A few other comic book related charities. This last year, however, we had one of our members, Stan Sakai, who draws Usagi Yojimbo for Dark Horse. His wife suffered what we thought at the time was a stroke. It turns out that it wasn't a stroke, but like a tumor that she had in her brain. And without being specific on what it was and whatnot, we saw an opportunity to help our friends through what we do. We saw that over a period of time that Stan was not himself.
Yeah.
You know, it's like you just know. I know because my mom and dad went through the same situation. My mom had a major stroke, and my father was the main caregiver of my mother. And so I saw my, and this is the best thing about it. I saw my father deteriorate.
Yeah.
But I saw him every day, so I didn't notice. We see Stan every month. So every 30 days, he'll walk in. When you don't see somebody every day, and you go and you see him once a month, you notice that
something's wrong.
He's tired, or he's not himself.
Yeah.
So I originally talked to the membership, and I said, let's do an auction. Let's do something about it. We're artists. Let's put something together. We'll do an auction, and we'll raise money to give him a hand, because even though he's got insurance and he's a well-known comic book artist, the real problem was that there are things that the insurance wasn't covering. And, you know, like silly things that you would assume would be covered. You know, like they needed to get a hospital bed because it was easier to get her
to manage.
Out.
Yeah.
Yeah. The wheelchair, whatever it was. Insurance covered this. It didn't cover that.
Yeah.
And whatever that nut was, without being specific, we just knew that there was something that we could do to help. So we started the auction, and it was a small little tiny thing. I literally went to a comic book show like this. I just started asking people, could you help out? We're collecting artwork. We're going to do an auction. All the money's going to go to Stan. And just like I was hoping, people just literally just started giving very lovingly and freely. And they did it because Stan is one of those people that everyone loves. No one can say a bad word about the man. Literally, I mean, to this day, the minute you go ahead and you talk and you suggest, oh, well, you know, Stan's the guy, you know who Stan is, everyone puts a smile on their face, they know him, they remember a meeting or a conversation or whatever, and everyone loves the man. And so people have been giving, again, generously to faults. Like, I sometimes get something and I go, are you sure this is okay?
Yeah, it's not going to hurt.
Absolutely, please, please, please. And then we had a huge break when we broke the news to Bleeding Cool. Bleeding Cool is another web comic book news source, and they ran an article about us doing this, and the entire thing just blew up. We went from collecting, you know, nice pieces at this little show to having amazing pieces come in from, you know, the likes of Michael Golden, Mike Mignola, Charles Vess. I feel horrible not mentioning some of these people. It's like we've gotten so many. Herberto Ramos.
Oh, my goodness.
Sergio Aragones. So many people gave of themselves and gave us these wonderful, wonderful pieces. And we then decided, it's like, you know, we were getting all these Usagi pieces. I'd kind of mentioned it to a few people. It's like, why don't you just do a Usagi piece and give it to us? And then I was thinking, maybe we'll do it like an art book. Then all of a sudden they were like, yeah, let's do an art book, but we gotta double check. Now it's a big giant art book that Dark Horse is putting out. They're basically donating, you know, the production of the book, the actual printing of the book.
Yeah.
The production of the book was done by Bill Morrison, who supervised the whole thing. And now we've got this big, giant art book that's going to be coming out the weekend of Comic-Con with all of these amazing artists in it, and all of the money that is raised by the purchase of the book is going to go to continue to help, you know, Stan and Sharon basically continue to address their medical.
Is there a deadline or cutoff time for the
art book is done. The art book is finished. The art book is totally wrapped up. One of the things we still have going on is all of the artwork that's in the art book. Was donated to us and is now currently being auctioned on eBay auctions. So every Thursday, 30 new items go up every week. They're up there for 10 days. And again, like clockwork, every Thursday, another, you know, batch of pages go up, another batch of covers. And again, there's so many pieces that came in, and there's still so many pieces that are going up in auctions. And all of the money from the eBay auctions also goes to help Stan and Sharon.
What are some of the things that go up for auction?
Again, a lot of covers. Again, all of the artwork that's in the art book will eventually go online. And again, I mean, at this point, it would almost be easier to mention people who aren't in the art book or people who haven't donated.
Yeah.
You know, but there's so many people who have given. And I mean, even at one point, I had people just giving us items. You know, there's
just because.
Yeah. Well, just, you know, again, and it was because I didn't know what we were going to do. It's like, we're just going to do this auction. People gave me like T-shirts and hats or like trinkets. Like somebody made jewelry and then gave us like some Usagi or Jimbo jewelry. One of the items that was in the auction just last week was this wonderfully crafted origami of the Usagi Yojimbo character.
Oh, this is so cool.
It was awesome.
Origami?
Origami.
Oh my God.
Of the character. It was like a little stand-up. It was amazing. And again, it just go on eBay and just check it out.
I'm going to save money.
Yeah, just
get it.
Just search. Yeah. Well,
spend it all here.
Oh, yeah, you know, spend it anywhere, but definitely get the art book because, again, that all goes to help stand out. So.
And what's your website again? Or how can people find you?
Find me. I'm on Facebook.
Facebook?
I love Facebook. It's super easy to find me. It's Tone Rodriguez Facebook or however you look us up. I don't know.
Got distracted by a robot.
Out. I can't find the address.
It's okay.
But Caps, I mean, again, Caps, eBay.
Definitely
anywhere.
Check it out.
Stan Sakai, Benefit, Art Book.
Awesome. Cool. Well, thank you so much, Tone.
No, thanks for coming. Oh, my God. You guys got me all messed up here.
No worries. We're all messed up. It's last day.
All right,
cool.
Awesome.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
So you've been talking about this on the show.
Since
you
the
want
first
your
day.
Own R2 unit.
Yes.
You want
I
to build one?
I want to buy and build one.
You know how?
No, I have no idea.
I don't either. But somebody who does is here. Hi, what's your name?
My name is Victor Franco. I'm with the R2 Builders Club.
Yeah, so the R2 Builders Club. Gee, I wonder what they do. So tell us a little bit about the R2 units that we have here.
Sure. These are fan-built replicas of the droids that you see in the movie. So this is my droid that I brought today, which is named R5-D4. He's under remote control, so I can turn his head and things like that. But you see a whole variety of droids that we have.
Oh, wait. He's not R5 until the motivator blows up, so can he do that?
Unfortunately, his motivator isn't so bad that it blows up, but you're right, that's what happens in the movie. So he doesn't do that quite yet. This is his first day out, actually, and I had R2-D2 out here Friday and Saturday.
See, actually, top secret, that's actually the one from the movie. He came here, the one they got in the movie, that's why it blew up. It was an imposter.
Oh, that makes sense now.
That's wink, wink, that's what it was. Yeah. Anyway, go ahead.
So, we build these as a hobby, and we take them to conventions and charitable events and occasionally high-profile things because Disney and Lucasfilm will ask us to get involved with something. So we do a little bit of everything.
Yeah, I was going to say, you're a Star Wars fan, I'm assuming?
Oh, yeah. Ever since I was little.
I couldn't tell.
Yeah.
So when did you start building? When did you think, you know what, I'm going to build my own R2 unit?
Well, I saw one of these things running around at an event in 2005, and I was a big fan of Star Wars and R2-D2, and I talked to the guy who built it, and he said, yeah, there's this club, and we build these things for fun. And I thought, I'll never do it. And then the next day, I joined the club, and then it took me almost 2 years, but I built my first droid in about a year and 10 months, and then I built the second one. I worked on it for another couple of years, and I finished this one.
So how much does it cost to start to make one?
Depending on what kind of material you use, you can build it for under $500, or you can go as much as what the average price of these is probably about $5,000.
Wow.
It's the aluminum that's the killer. That's expensive. When you have a dome that's made out of real aluminum, that can be $500 by itself. The motors cost a lot of money, batteries, electronics, it adds up fast.
Where do you go get the parts? I mean, do you go to your local hardware store and say, I need parts from my R2, where do I go? What section? Where do you get the parts?
R2 section of Walmart. So in my case, I built the legs out of plywood myself. So I just got out the table saw and I built these out of wood. But the metal part of the skins, one of the club members makes. So we have guys in the club that will say, okay, how many people need the white part on the body? And 100 people say, yeah, I need those. And they go, okay, let me get a quote from a shop. It's going to cost this much money. It's going to take this long. And you PayPal your money in, and the guy handles the run of the parts. And then you get them in the mail 6 months later. And that's eventually how you get a droid. So you can build it yourself or you can buy parts. But we don't have kits. So it's really kind of one part at a time.
That makes it easy.
Yeah.
And how do you... how do you start again? Like, do you guys come up with the concept drawing, or do you have a blueprint?
That's a good question.
Because I don't know how to build anything.
We have full blueprints in the club, so you can kind of see our website on the banner is astromech.net. When you join up with the club, you get access. It's free to join, free blueprints. And then in my case, I'll show you what I built first on the inside. I built that wooden frame, so
wow.
I kind of built it from the inside out. So I built the frame first because it doesn't have to look perfect. It just needs to, you know, hold the droid together.
Wow.
And then I worked on the legs and then the outside of the body and things like that.
That's so cool.
Plus, like you said earlier, it's an R5, so if it doesn't quite work, it's...
Exactly. That's
it's great.
It's accurate.
It's accurate.
Yeah.
Where is the R2 builders? Where are they located?
Well, we're all local to Southern California, but the club itself is international. So we got people building R2 units all over the country and, in fact, all over the world.
Building an army.
Yeah.
So if somebody's probably jumping up and down, I want to join, how do they join?
The best way is to go to our website, astromech.net. Like I say, it's just a hobbyist thing. We're not trying to make money off of it. In fact, we're not allowed to make money off of it because of Lucasfilm and Disney copyrights. But we can do it as a hobby, and we can do charitable events and things like that.
I think I know what I want to do in the summer.
Yeah, so she's going to join. You guys join up. Astromech. What is it again? Astromech.net. You know, the website, we'll put it on the description down below. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome. Thank you.
That is so cool. So it's Angel here, obviously, but we also have our Henry. Why are you tired?
It's day 3. We're done.
We can't be done.
But look at all the exclusives we got for you guys. We got TNT's brand new shows, Legends, The Last Ship.
Yes, we
did. The Superhero Lounge got that for you. Go to their Twitter.
They have heck of pictures.
They have audio for you guys on their upcoming show on Friday. They're going to talk about what we did here at Vacation. Superheroes, they take vacations too. They really do. They got to wash those trunks and those tights every now and then.
Ew.
When they come rescue you, and even your Batman.
I don't want my
leather.
Batman. I like him clean with his leather.
Let's stop it.
I like leather.
What else did we do? We did 20th Century Fox. You guys get to see from. You know him as Commissioner.
Gordon.
You guys may know him as Sirius Black. Everybody else may know him as Gary Oldman. His parents probably know him as Gary Oldman. He's on there too. Andy Serkis, Gollum, is there also. He plays Caesar in Dawn of the Planet of the Apes. He gets some stuff from there. Friend of the show, James Dashner, he was on talking about The Maze Runner. I saw Thomas. He's supposedly one of those big MTV stars. I'm always going to know him as Thomas because I love the book. And Gally was there also. All of you Maze Runners, you fans, you know who I'm talking about. Who else did we get? A bunch of people. Just, again, follow all of us at Geek Speak Angel. That's yours, right?
Yeah, that is mine. Yeah.
At Geek Speak Show 1, at the Super Lounge, at Talk of Fame. Albert Lawrence is out there also. He got to talk to Doug Jones from Falling Skies. Got some good stuff from him. And some he talked to the Son of Batman. Wait till you guys hear. See actually the interview with the Son of Batman, the actor who plays the Son of Batman.
And I'll Batman's say, son, which is so cute.
If you have a 3D computer, step back because he might kick you in the face. A little hint there. So, you ready for the next one? For us, for some of you, it may be sometime in the middle of San Diego.
Super Bowl.
But for us, it's in San Jose. Those of you in the Bay Area, we're coming back. We have to, I guess.
Well, maybe we can get a little bit of sun, but a little bit of shopping and
two
I don't want to leave.
Coming up. In our budget, in your budget, free comic book day, first Saturday in May. We're going to be there. Where else? Flying Colors Comics and other cool stuff. We'll see you there. We'll see, like, two nights before The Amazing Spider-Man 2.
Part 2?
And I will tell you how bad it really... I'll tell you how it was and if you really do want to go or not.
Or if you want to kiss Spider-Man upside down again.
That was Tobey Maguire. That's the right one.
Yeah.
And then after that, also in May, Big Wow Comic Fest in San Jose. We'll be there for that one. You'll be there for that one. Got a little surprise on the next show, so be sure to listen, not just to the YouTube channel here, to our show, because Angel's on there. I'm on there. But listen anyway, because Angel's still there. So we'll see you, I don't know. Do you want to do a show next week? Or you want to take a break?
Why the hell not? Why do we need a break?
Because I forgot, I'm also going to Chicago. C2E2 next weekend. I'll see you guys there. And the guys from A Graphic Conversation, they'll graphically cover C2E2.
You'll be in like 3D.
And so will I. We'll see you there. The Geek Speak Show, everywhere. You will be too.